Good morning and good afternoon. I'd like to welcome you all to a LexisNexis complimentary webinar titled Beyond Websites, Expert Tips for Marketing Your Firm. Before introducing our speakers, we have a few announcements. Today's program is not eligible for CLE credit. For our phone participants only, if a problem arises during the program, please dial *0 for the operator. Please take note of the survey that is available to you. We ask that you please complete it as it provides excellent feedback for us so that we may continue to bring you outstanding programs that meet your needs. Our speakers today welcome your questions. You may submit your questions via the Q&A section of the platform throughout our program today. We will try to address as many audience questions as possible, but please keep in mind all questions may not be answered due to time constraints. No questions will be asked verbally. And now I'd like to introduce today's speakers. Adam Miller is the Director of Sales and Business Development, and Ken Tippins is SEO Manager at Vertical Nerve. Vertical Nerve is a digital optimization firm that focuses on helping clients acquire more traffic and convert more sales and leads. Paul Grabowski is the Chief Marketing Officer at Bracewell LLP. He has been involved in various facets of business development, marketing, media relations, communications, administration, and operations for more than 20 years, and is the co-author of The ABCs of Legal Marketing. Today's webinar is moderated by Deborah McMurray, CEO and Strategy Architect for Content Pilot LLC. Content Pilot is a woman-owned, Dallas-headquartered marketing strategy and technology company founded in 2005 that served leading law firms and other professional services firms across the United States. Deborah, the floor is yours.
Thank you so much, Kathleen. Good morning and good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for spending your what sort of lunch hour or around your lunch hour with us. We have a lot to cover today, and here is what you will learn. The top five things that insiders know about Google, knowing that SEO is so much more than getting found on Google, will show you how to build a strategy that works for your practice and industry, what lawyers can do to build reputation online and offline, what your lawyer bios on your website must have to make you stand out, what kind of investment is realistic and how long it takes, how you can measure success, the difference between organic search and paid search, how to gain visibility when launching a new practice, and knowing where to hang out to improve your Google search results using social media and so on. That's a tall order, so we are all going to speak fast, and we do want time at the end to answer your questions. Ken, everyone wants to know about Google, so tell us what we need to know to get started.
Absolutely. So five of the key things that we like to say that we know here, particularly when it comes to inside information when dealing with Google, is that Google is always in a constant state of change, whether that's ranking algorithm shifts, whether that's quality shifts. There's always something constantly in a state of flux with Google. The second thing is content. We hear it constantly over and over, it's repetitious, but it still holds true today. Content is and probably forever will be king. Third thing, mobile. Here recently, mobile search has recently overtaken desktop search, particularly when it comes to organic search. Just because more than likely your users, they're going to more likely be out and about constantly in transit, whether it's a quick search or just a quick search out of curiosity, more likely they're going to be on a tablet or a mobile device of some sort. Another thing that we like to pride ourselves on knowing is that the customer's opinions actually count, whether that takes the forms of reviews, testimonials. Customers like to know that their opinions count. They like to see their opinions in review boxes, and Google loves it as well. That's one of their key ranking factors. It's a good indication that the customer is getting good service and the business is actually doing pretty good business, right? The fifth thing is that Google is no longer just a organic channel. The path forward is going to be multi-channel.
And Ken, quickly, what do you mean by multi-channel?
Sure, so multi-channel in this sense, we're referring to the different avenues that we can reach customers. So whether that's print, radio, television, whether it's paid search and Google search engine results page, it could be organic search, any avenue that we can take to really reach out to our potential customers and clients. Even social media is its own channel now. So.
Okay, great, thank you. Paul, there's a danger of treating SEO like a thing, and you all can't see me, but I'm using air quotes right now as I around the word thing. Rather than a long-term commitment, help us understand how strategy should play into it.
Absolutely. The old model has always been for lawyers, businesses, et cetera, we create a website, and then we ask ourselves, what are we doing with it? You know, the obvious thing for lawyers and law firms is, well, we build a website and we're going to get clients. The difficulty is now, as Ken was pointing to about multi-channel and some of the other things that we need to consider, the time and the analytics have changed this entire landscape for us. So building a website and hoping and praying that clients are going to come or look at it or see the information just isn't the same anymore. So what we're talking about is how to build a website strategy. And when you're thinking about a website, whether you're building it for the first time or you're reviewing and revamping what you already have, you want to really focus on grabbing your viewers' attention. What is it that's going to make them want to come to your site? What is it going to make, how are they going to want to stay on your site? And to do that, you really have to figure out what's going to make you different. In today's world, as many lawyers know, supply outweighs demand, and you want to find your niche, your specialty, and be able to promote it. Ultimately, you want to strive to build trust with the users and viewers of your site. They want to come back. They want to find information that is relevant to what they have going on so that you have an opportunity to turn a contact into a client. So some of the steps that you want to consider in this strategy is take a look and see who is your ideal client. Who do you want to work with? What industry do you want to be in? And then get to know them and that industry. One of the biggest things that we hear from general counsels and clients is our lawyers don't always know our business. And so the best way to do that in building a website is make it for them. In doing so, you want to organize your content. What is it that you want to put out there? One of the things that we suggest people do when building a website is take a look at who their clients are and see how they organize their information. To do that, you have to plan and implement a content strategy. It's not just, like I said at the beginning, building a website and they will come, but having a content strategy of how you're going to update it. What is your update schedule? What information are you going to put out there that's going to make it relevant? And so once you have all of these things, test it. Then think about how you're going to improve it, and if it works, then repeat it, so that you're ultimately driving traffic to your site. So to get started, know what your goals are and what they are from a marketing standpoint. Why is it that you want to make an investment in having a website, a social media platform, all of these things that at the end of the day are driving sales to your firm? And thinking about that in your ideal client, what are their characteristics? What are they? What industries are they in? Who are their clients, and how can you use that to your advantage? And so we look at what are your industry targets? Is it a particular area you want to be in? Is it a particular client that you want? You know, understanding what those targets are in advance of building your content strategy makes it much more efficient on the back end. And ultimately, we always tell people, answer the question, why would I hire you? We talk about the plaudits of what we have done, the cases we've managed, the schools that we went to. But at the end of the day, a client is looking at the content on your website, making a decision as to whether or not to hire you to handle their particular matter. So in terms of that content strategy, you want to look at the next steps. Find the most effective way to deliver what it is you do. It may be a website. It may be some other form of electronic media that's out there. But knowing what that is on the front end makes you spend less time on the back end in terms of trying to promote yourself. Educate yourself and your buyers as to what the content is and how you should be portraying it. The big thing is you don't want to just provide legal advice to someone. They can get legal advice anywhere. You want to make yourself distinct as opposed to just being someone else who's out there doing the same thing. And ultimately, you want to develop some action steps. What is it you're going to do? What content are you going to have? What research are you going to put into it? And then what are you going to promote to others who are viewing your site? So some of the things that you really need to do, develop a list of the most common questions that clients ask you. It's always good to talk to your clients. There's somewhat of an inversion sometimes in saying, well, do I really want to talk to my client? Did I do a good job? What are they going to say? Maybe I already know the answers. But having frequent conversations with your clients can help you build a content strategy. Determine it is from those responses, what makes you different from your competition? And how can you use that to your advantage? And consider the states that people go through before they become a client. Why are they buying your services? Why are they looking at you? What makes you different? How are they going to get their services, and what is most important to them? So ultimately, we tell people to use the KISS method. Keep it simple. You know, people look at a web page for an average of 8 seconds or less to find what they're looking for. If you go on and add everything from 10 years ago, it may not be relevant. And so that's where using the analytics can come into play in order to make sure that what you're putting out there is what people want to see. So some other things that you really need to consider in putting this content strategy together, think about answering those common questions from clients. But more importantly, demystify your areas of practice. We talk about things, being a lawyer myself, we learned from law school, these are the classes that we take, whether it's public law or secure transactions. That may not be common nomenclature to the people that you're trying to have as clients. So give them an idea of how you work firsthand and some of the accounts of your successes. What makes you different? Incorporate comments from clients if you can. More importantly, you want to incorporate keywords for this SEO, search engine optimization. So one of the things to think about is if you're focusing on a particular industry or a particular client, take a look at the About Us section of how they describe themselves and how you can incorporate that into your website. And ultimately, you have to now think outside the box. I talked at the beginning how time and analytics have changed, but a website is not the end point anymore. You have to think, how are you going to drive content to your website? And so you want to think, how can I incorporate the use of video? Do I particularly like to post on blogs? What other social medias out there that I can use to my advantage? And finally, you never want to stop. Like I said, a website alone is not going to get you clients. You have to think about cross-promoting other avenues of social media. You know, if you have a Twitter handle, if you are using a blog, if you have video and you're using YouTube, how can you in turn drive traffic back to your site? One of the things that you can look at is, what are your clients using? You know, is the CEO of that company you're working for on Twitter? Do you follow him? What is he doing? What is he posting? How can you use that to your advantage to be proactive? And then ultimately, you want to check the analytics. And I'll let Ken and Adam talk about some of the analytics that are out there, but there's some very basic ones that Google provides that can really enhance what you're doing from a website perspective.
Thank you, Paul. Speaking of Twitter, we are on Twitter, and we hope that that if the listeners today are on Twitter, we hope that you will be tweeting, and we will give you some information about that at the end in terms of our handles and hashtags and things to use. So speaking of Twitter and social media, we receive 30,000 messages each day based on studies that have been done actually for the last 20 years, starting with the New York Times. 20 years ago, it was 10,000 messages a day. Today, with all of the mobile, all of the social media, everything, we know we are receiving 30,000 messages a day. And the only way we can deal with this blizzard of messages is to tune out those that don't stick in our short and long-term memory. And we do this. We all do this. Consciously, subconsciously, and unconsciously. And in each category of products and services, we can only recall two or three names. For example, toothpaste. Quick! Besides Crest and Colgate, what comes to mind? It's hard to think of that third toothpaste brand. So your challenge and your opportunity is to cut through all this noise. The way for you to build reputation online and offline is first, and you all know this, by getting great results for your clients and having them spread the word. But second, you have to create content. Ken mentioned it, Paul mentioned it. You have to generate content. We recommend that firms embrace a 360-degree content strategy where you are pushing and pulling content. In other words, you're distributing it to and from all these sources. Every major practice and industry area should have its own content strategy. Who are the buyers of those services? How fast do they make decisions? What are they buying from you? What do those buyers read, and where do they spend their time? For SEO to work hard for you, you have to work hard for it. I believe what's good for human visitors will also be good for SEO. And the greatest challenge for lawyers is having the time. I know how busy everyone is, having the time to create new content. So in this strategy, the 360-degree strategy in this infographic, create content once and leverage it as often as you can. And note by this diagram that you're leveraging and syndicating content from every online and offline source, including one-to-one conversations. So if you look at sort of the lower left of this infographic, you'll see one-to-one relationships. Right underneath it, you'll see word of mouth. And then articles and publications. Those can be offline and online. Experience, your specific expertise and experience. But then I want to really highlight the term here, micro moments. What are those? We all know that it's difficult and expensive to change perceptions of you or of anything at a big picture level, a macro level, since buyers hang on to and protect broadly held beliefs. But at the micro level, you have an opportunity to design touch points that are distinguishing, relevant, and meaningful, and touch points that actually turn heads. Google, in a recent study focused on mobile, calls these micro moments and describes micro moments as the new battleground for brands. People are not making big decisions anymore. They're making a series of tiny little decisions that tack on to each other, and then they ultimately get to the big decision. So it's a journey. It's not I go from A to Z. It's this journey through the alphabet to get me to that big decision. To win the reputation battle and to win more work, you have to understand how buyers of legal services buy. Whether companies or individuals, whether business to business, you have a business to business practice or a business to consumer practice, when buyers are creating their shortlist, they're making an intellectual evaluation based on things like relevant expertise, experience, geography, maybe fee arrangements, results, a whole range of things, things that they can actually check off a list. So they're using their brain to make that evaluation, and then that gets you on the shortlist. But when they are choosing the one lawyer or firm to hire, they're making an emotional decision. Do I trust you? Do I like you? How would I feel if I got stuck on the tarmac with you for 5 hours? Would it be painful or would it be a party? So to get hired, you have to first prove that you can address the issues that most concern them on an intellectual level, and then you have to prove that you're nice to work with. So you essentially have to sell twice. Talking about your website, you know that visitors go to a law firm website to view biographies. That's the reason that they go. But you may not have known that the number was so high. Based on the analytics that we track, 40 to 70% of all visitors view the lawyer biographies. So you have two goals. Keep visitors on your bio longer, on your particular bio longer, and if you have more than one lawyer in your firm, convert visitors to viewing more of them. How do you do that? I've been thinking a lot about this. So I created a concept called three-dimensional lawyer biographies, or 3D lawyer bios. And it doesn't matter who your ultimate target audience is, all buyers will respond well to the three-dimensional lawyer biographies. And the three dimensions are demonstrate expertise, prove relevancy, and show humanity. The first dimension, demonstrate expertise, you have to answer the question, what have you done, for whom have you done it, and what can you do for me? And if you don't answer these questions, you are not passing the shortlist test I mentioned a moment ago. You can't ultimately be hired if you aren't winning here. Prospects also love short case studies because it not only gives them the details of your experience, but it shows how you did something, what the issues were, and how you did something. The second dimension is prove relevancy, and the first place it's tested is in a Google search for your name, or any search engine search for your name. What shows up in the little snippet, the first 140 characters or so of your bio, that's what's going to show up in this Google snippet. If it's not filled with important keywords about what you do today, you're missing out. You should consider this the most valuable real estate you own on the internet. Other things to improve your relevancy and help your SEO, for example, feed in, if you're, as Paul mentioned, you're a blogger or you tweet, feed in those posts to your website and to your bio in particular. For example, and also if you've written a book or have some other thought leadership, boast about it. And also structure the design of your bio page so it's easily seen by people. Put it in a box or a container, for example. I want to mention a word about awards badges, such as super lawyers and best lawyers, and so on. Most lawyers I know love to include all these badges on their biographies. They do not prove relevancy, however. So you are not passing this the second dimension by including those badges. If you include them, you really need to make sure you're featuring substance on your bio as well. At least corporate buyers of legal services say that awards such as super lawyers do not influence their hiring decision. And the final dimension is to show humanity. And this is the second level of selling I mentioned earlier, the emotional level. You have to connect with your prospect on an emotional level to get hired. The first thing is to have a terrific and current photo. We too often see lawyers' photos from 10 years ago, 15 years ago, with glasses, without glasses, with that extra 10 pounds, without it, with hair or without hair. The key is to build trust is to actually keep your photos very current. We use the term magazine style, kind of a large format photo. What we're trying to do is show you as friendly and accessible. Great video, and I'm now using air quotes again around the word great, video can really get you closer to being hired, and it's also a great SEO asset. But make sure it's well produced and make sure it's no longer than 20 or 30 seconds. We are also including more and more in the websites that we build what we call after hours or out of the office features on the bio. Clients want points of alignment and intersection with their lawyers. They want to like them. So if you're a tennis or a golf aficionado, or if you love travel to the capital cities of Europe, or you're a master griller or gardener, whatever it is, share it. Someone might see that, and it will be just the one thing that they need to tip you over the hedge so they can hire you. And here's the bottom line. The only way to get hired more is to connect more meaningfully with the person doing the hiring. There are countless choices out there besides you. Prove that you are the right lawyer to hire. So, Adam, I'm now going to turn it over to you to talk about time and money. What kind of investment you have to take?
The two most important things, right? Time and money. I mean, I think it's really important to keep first and remember that this really is an investment. It's something that's supposed to work for you. So, you know, we have a lot of great experience, obviously, here at Vertical Nerve. Part of us being a tier one agency here with Google Now is that, you know, they've kind of opened up a lot of information to us and even some of their formulas. So a big thing on the SEO side to remember is when it comes down to your individual company, it's different for everyone. So the way to really calculate the type of investment that you really need to make, something that's realistic for you guys, is really to take and look at the practice or practices that you want to cover. Plus the actual market that you want to cover, whether it's a national campaign or if it's just local to your individual city or state. And then obviously you have to take into consideration the type of competition that you have in that market for those practices. You really need to make sure that you're not spreading yourself too thin, but still making sure that you're being able to really compete in that market space. So a big thing to remember as well is, you know, nowadays everyone is wants instant gratification. On the SEO side, that's something that's really, it can be something you can expect, but it's something that, you know, you don't want to give yourself a wrong expectation. Patience is really a virtue. It really is a marathon, not a sprint, but it doesn't mean that you can't see results right away. Whether you are a brand new firm that has a brand new site, and you're really kind of trying to develop and steal some of that market share, or whether you already have a current site and we need to go in and maybe make a little bit of tweaks to some things, there are definitely some things and some really good gains that you can see within the first couple of months. It's all about the current status of where you're at, and again, that competition level. But there's a lot of things that we can, that you can do early on to really see some good quality, consistent upticks. And the other thing too to remember is it's all about consistency. You can't just be online 1 month or doing SEO 1 month and then not doing it the following and then on and off. It's all about consistency. I think, more like a snowball. It's something that you're going to consistently be gaining ground on everyone else and kind of climbing that mountain. With it being coming up here on beach season, it's a really good analogy to think of fitness. It's very difficult to get into really good shape. It takes time and a lot of consistency. It doesn't take a whole lot of time to get out of shape. So the moment that you stop working and being progressive on the SEO side, you will start to see declines. So, it's a really good idea when you're doing SEO, when you're doing search engine optimization, to try to supplement it with other marketing, right? So you want to make sure that you are doing some other things like SEM, which is search engine marketing, which is more like a pay-per-click, something to that effect, something like remarketing or even like some programmatic display or email, something else to kind of supplement. SEO by itself is something that can be very helpful, but really when you want to see the most and get the most out of your SEO, a lot of times when you can supplement it with other marketing, you can actually see a lot even faster upticks and consistent growth over time. I mean, SEO is something that's going to build, but if you can supplement it because it does take some time to gain momentum in any specific market, a lot of times you can do a lot of paid search, SEM, to kind of supplement those first few months and then obviously start to decline that as you're starting to regulate and come up as more on the SEO side. So you can kind of balance them out and use them together to kind of, two or three ropes on the same side of the sled. The last part to really take into consideration, like I said before, is every firm is very much unique. Anyone you work with, anybody who says that they have some kind of cookie cutter approach to be able to see great results in the legal space or something like that, some of the pure plays or some of the people that would, say that they already kind of have a template built out, that's a red flag. That's something you want to be a little bit leery on because, again, no firm is exactly the same as another. There's always different, unique attributes to every company. So there's certain things that you need to remember, to kind of stay away from or be careful of. But again, it's everyone's unique. Everybody is like their own snowflake. You want to make sure that It's your SEO is tiered to your specific company. The next part that we want to make sure that we're covering is really how to measure that success. So what does that mean to you? It could be different across different companies, right? So it's very, very important to sit down in the process, whether you're currently doing SEO or not, to really figure out what do I consider success? Where are we currently at and what goals are we specifically trying to hit? It's very important that you can sit down and have those definitive goals over a period of time, 3 months, 6 months, 12 months, 5 years, and then really sit down and try to figure out, and what an SEO firm would do is they would sit down and set up what we call KPIs, their key performance indicators. What they're showing is that we are hitting the necessary steps of what it takes to get to the next level. Or, if we're trying to get to a certain number of new leads that we're trying to generate, or certain rankings that we're trying to generate or show up in the map section, there are certain things that it takes to do all of those things, and we have the ability to have that checklist basically to go up and say, we want to hit this, to hit this. Ken, if you want to walk them through some of the SMART goals, I think it makes a lot of sense for them as well.
Yeah, absolutely. So one of the things we do to really try to measure success is to use what we call SMART goals, just because we want to make sure the goals are realistic and attainable. So a lot of times you'll hear just generic goals, I want more leads. Well, what does that mean? Is one extra lead, is that considered success, or is it, just kind of marginal? So we take that approach and we really try to refine it and turn that into something that's actionable. So with SMART goals, the things we want to measure is what's specific about the goal? Is it unique? Is it something that we can reach for? Or is this a part of something else that really doesn't make sense to be its own goal in its own sense? Is the goal measurable? How do we know that this goal can be achieved? Is it something that we can actually line up a yardstick to and say that, hey, we've actually done this, we can check it off the box? The A is for achievable. So we want to make sure that we can actually make sure that we can actually cross that finish line with it, right? Like, what is the success of that specific goal? Also, is it relevant? Is the goal relevant to performance expectations or professional development, whether it's client development, whether it's business goals in terms of sales? Does it pertain to the business and growing that overall customer base? And lastly, is it time-bound? We always want to make sure that we are setting goals that are not only realistic, but also to put them in a time restraint, just to help with efficiency, to help measure how long it takes for the goal to be executed, how long it takes for us to reach this certain level of just goal achievement, right? And time-bound really helps to kind of narrow that in, whether it's quarterly goals, whether it's annual goals, or even month-over-month goals. We want to make sure that we have some form of time constraint to really measure that stick by. And so in this slide, we'll talk about how we actually measure success. So conversion success, we typically want to measure that by ROI, sales, anything that we can use to really signify growth. Whether that's leads, it could be email subscriptions, it could be followers on social media, anything that we can really use to kind of make sure that we're actually hitting incremental growth. Because incremental growth is really what you want to strive for, just because incremental growth is more maintainable. Everyone likes the pikes, everyone likes those peaks, but we really want to make sure that we can maintain that growth over a long period of time, instead of just having that one big splurge and then everything just sort of is marginal ever since. And we typically measure that by the number of people that actually come in and convert. There's also an aspect of content success as well. So as I referenced earlier and a couple of other speakers, content is extremely valuable to Google, and which means it's extremely valuable to success in Google. And so one of the ways that we measure content success is by looking at how many times a person comes to the page, what is the topic of the page, how long they're actually staying on that page. Is the bounce rate going up? Is it going down? Are they sharing the content? Are they coming in from posts that were shared on social media channels. We really want to look at the content and how people are engaging with that content. Are they coming to the page, staying for 5 and 10 minutes, or are they coming and staying for 5 or 6 seconds? Each case, it requires a certain approach, you know, whether that's more robust content, whether we need to scale the content down, or even just look at different forms of content, whether that's infographics, videos, it could be PowerPoint slides. And so we really need to figure out how our potential customers and clients really engage with content. Is it, you know, do they like the social media format, something that's small, concise, and straight to the point, or do they like to sit down and read and get each and every bullet point that they can? And so there are a couple of different metrics that we use, but we definitely look at bounce rate when it comes to content. We definitely look at the social aspect of it in terms of did they come in from a social channel or are they sharing it socially themselves as well. So,
yeah, and I think a really great way to make sure that you're keeping all of these metrics straight and kind of being able to look in at a glance on a daily level to see, you know, how are we doing, you know, how are we doing so far this month or this week or this year, is to really make sure that you have some type of quality analytics platform, whether it's standard Google Analytics. I think that the standard-based Google Analytics is probably sufficient enough for most firms. For most people, it's more about how many total hits that you're actually getting and whether it's a necessity. You know, if you're a company that happens to own a lot of different brands, you need to be able to kind of see the results across the board. You know, most of the time, your standard Google Analytics is going to work for you. If you happen to have a great number of total hits or total traffic, you could look into the idea of having Google Analytics 360, which is formerly Google Analytics Premium, or something like an Adobe, you know, the Site Catalyst, something to that effect. But realistically, that's probably something that's just standard Google Analytics, at least, is something that would probably be sufficient for most. You just need to make sure that it's very much cleaned up, and that way you can really trust your data. Because at the end of the day, if you know, you can do all the SEO or pay-per-click or anything as you want, but if you can't trust the data that you're seeing, you're not really sure what your current status is and how you're actually doing.
I want to quickly jump in before you start talking about organic and paid searches. There were a couple of questions about whether the slides would be available, and yes, the answer is yes, they will be, as well as a recording of today's presentation, and LexisNexis will alert you a little bit more about that at the end, but I just wanted to insert that. So now let's get into the differences between paid and organic searches.
Yeah, absolutely. Ken, you want to go ahead?
Sure. So two of the primary channels that are really big today are the organic search and paid search. Here we'll kind of go through some of the differences and really try to explain when and where you should use them. In a perfect world, you will want to use these in tandem because they one hand really does help the other in this situation. But if you're testing things out and trying to find out which channel really is a better fit for your specific practice, we'll just go over a couple points of how you can benefit from either one in their own respective, right? So paid search is driven by an auction-style platform where you typically bid on keywords or you bid on keyword placement, right? And so it's great for jump-starting traffic. If you have a new website or you have a promotion come up or if you're doing a special event, this is great to drive that immediate traffic to the website or to an event landing page, because it's instant. It doesn't really take a lot of building. It's just you go in, you optimize for your keywords, optimize for region specific, or even you can get as granular as city specific. You set your targets. You go in and you actually set how much you want to bid for the keywords, and that's pretty much it in a nutshell. There are more strategies there, but That's the 50,000 foot view of it.
Yeah, and realistically, it's something where you literally are only paying when you get clicked on. So it's something where you don't want to have to pay for every click that people have to get to your site. But it's something that, again, like Ken said, if you're trying to expand market, you're a company that's here in Dallas. and then you're also wanting to try to expand your market and you want to test out Austin or Houston, you can do paid search in those areas to see how the market actually reacts to you. That way you know if it's something that you need to expand and have a location there or something to that effect, or just have better representation. But it's a great way to be able to test new markets and gain new visibility. And it's really focused on people who are usually in the buying cycle, somebody who is ready maybe for more of a purchase, given for the legal spectrum, and for that market or industry, it's something that usually has a longer buying cycle. But really, that's kind of what that paid search is really driven for. You're essentially paying for that click or that view for people to be able to see you.
Absolutely. So like I said, it is great for that immediate traffic boost. It's really great for targeting specific events, things like that. And it's a great way to really figure out keywords in terms of where people are in the buying funnel, like Adam just referenced, whether that's targeting people that are at the top, lower, middle, bottom, just with a generic search such as I want a traffic lawyer in Dallas versus I want a traffic lawyer in the North Dallas area, right? You can get as granular as you want to with specific keywords. And so now on the opposite end of the spectrum with organic search is more of a long-term strategy. So organic search would be the strategy that you would use to actually build your website's domain authority. It would be used to rank individual pages. So whereas paid search, you would go out and you would send traffic to a specific page. What organic search does is it helps that specific page with on-site elements such as title tags, meta descriptions, things such as schema, relevant content, specific content, and Google, in this case, instead of bidding for it, Google goes in, looks at your website, crawls it, and sees that your website is more relevant to this specific search query and returns that page in the results, preferably the first page results. But one thing about Google and their algorithms is that here recently they've shifted to an AI-based algorithm. So the rankings are a little bit more volatile here recently. So we're trying to be as proactive as that with that. But the key thing that we want to really keep in mind here with organic search is that it's extremely local focused. It's extremely local focused. It's extremely mobile focused. And that there are going to be cycles with the algorithms. But in terms of a long-term strategy, organic search is the better option of the two, just because you get traffic organically because it's relevant to a particular search query in a specific region.
Thanks, guys. We're going to switch gears and talk about we've been talking about visibility a lot, but and we've shared quite a number of things we can do. But Paul, what are some other things that lawyers can do?
Thanks, Deborah. You know, when we look at this and some of the things that we've talked about, a lot of times we get to a point of saying we spent all this money on a website, so now what do we do? You know, Ken and Adam just talked about the different organic versus paid sites, systems that you can use. Ultimately, we want to make our site visible. And so taking in those analytics is a great way to find ways to drive traffic to your site. You know, I think we've talked about it from the first slide on through that fresh content is absolutely the thing that needs to keep driving content and people to your site and ultimately gain you visibility. So going back to, again, that target audience, as we say from a business development perspective, whether it's you're talking about websites or you're talking about how to just gain business in general, your contacts are absolutely critical, and people do business with people they know, like, and trust. Deborah mentioned that in terms of the two sales pieces that you need when trying to get new clients. You know, these are things that we have to keep in mind, and those contacts to lawyers in general should be treated as your gold mine. That's what you use constantly and should be updating and keeping relevant and using to your advantage. So we want to be organized with those contacts. How often do we stay up with them? How do we divide them? What are the ones that are most relevant? Those are the ones that you want to use to promote news updates, your content, your practices. But ultimately, you want to make sure that all of that messaging about what you do once you found your target audience and what you're looking for to sell, that that messaging is consistent throughout all of your platforms. You know, and we talked about it a little bit, but there is a sales cycle to this. And what we all have to understand at the heart of it all, lawyers are salespeople. We can no longer wait for the phone to ring. We can no longer think that where we went to law school and what we did was the most important thing, and that's going to bring us clients. So every time that you're in contact with those clients, you want to collect that information and use it to your advantage. You know, what are they doing? How are they doing it? How do you stay in contact with them? Ultimately, you want to actively follow up with them. With what you're posting out there, what's going to drive traffic to your site is how relevant you're making yourselves to them. And you ultimately want to work to convert all of those contacts you have into clients, knowing that each one is going to have a different buying cycle. So you want to plan ahead. You want to gain visibility, and it doesn't stop at that website launch. You want to think about putting together a six-month calendar. We talked about profiles, and that's where people go to look at a website. They look at attorney bios. You should be thinking and having calendared that every 6 months you are making some kind of edits or review of your profile and the content on your website. Then you want to incorporate your website content into that other outreach that you're doing. Again, going back to those other platforms that are available to you, you want to ultimately make it consistent that you are selling this and you are keeping it consistent throughout your site and all of your channels that you're using. And to do that, you really have to be committed. This is something that you have to do. You can't just, as I said at the beginning, launch a website, get clients. You have to be committed to using these mediums to your advantage.
Paul,
so how do you?
And
yep.
Yeah. Oh, I'm sorry. Let's
no, it's quite all right.
Yeah.
So you know, gaining. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
Ahead,
wrong
Paul.
One.
No worries, Paul. Adam, I know you have a few things to add about gaining visibility.
Right. Yeah. I think part of with gaining visibility is, you know, when you're a relatively new firm, or if you're somebody who's kind of maybe retooling or redoing the site, if you're really starting from scratch, it's really, really important to build up your foundation. And by that, I mean the technical piece of your SEO, which is all of your on-site SEO. You know, so making sure that you have good site structure and good URL structure, making sure that you have a mobile-friendly site, making sure that the actual site speed, so it loads fast enough. You know, if it loads slow, your bounce rate is going to go through the roof. Making sure that all the pages are linked together correctly so that the experience you get on the page is the way it should be. You know, those things are really, really important, and it's really the base foundation of your SEO home, basically. Without those things, you can't get the full amount of credit out of all the content and all the authority and all the other things that you're doing. Again, don't forget, like I know Ken kind of mentioned this, don't forget your meta and schema. That's your metadata, your meta tags and title tags, and your HTML schema. It's basically what you would add to all the content on the site and new content that you'd be putting into a blog or something to that effect to really beef up and get the most value out of all the content that's on the site. So making sure it's as crawlable on when Google goes through and is, you know, if somebody searches into a query and it searches a keyword, making sure that they can find that on the site and that it pertains to what they're searching for. And also the cadence of your content is extremely important. Again, I preach consistency, but making sure that it's not just one new piece of content or something every other month or something to that effect. You have to be really consistent. And that helps really with creating your authority, making sure that, you know, locally you are the best option that they can find locally for the type of practice that you have. And then making sure, lastly, that you have really good quality links. So making sure that when other people are linking to your site, or when there's linking between two sites, you know, making sure that you're trying to focus on making sure that you get good link outreach to like your Chamber of Commerce, something that's very local specific that has like a .edu or a .gov. Those things can do a lot to help you rank locally and to get the visibility in your local market that you absolutely need to have.
That was great. In fact, one of the questions that that one of our viewers asked was about linking and a new website linking to more established, relevant industry websites. And yes, exactly what you just said, Adam. We have just a few minutes left, and so we're going to do the next part, this last section of our presentation, very quickly. So, Paul and Ken, we're going to get your final thoughts about, you know, there are a lot of lawyers on this call. Where should they spend their valuable time? Where should they hang out? Paul, how about you first?
Sure. I think as I went back to or repeating from a little bit ago, you really need to know your clients and what are they using. Are they on LinkedIn, Facebook, Twitter, Pinterest, you name it. There's 100 of them out there that you can go do, but you want to mirror those clients. You know, one of the interesting things is there's 180 million users on LinkedIn right now. That is an excellent platform to be connecting with others and being able to push your content out to those who may want to find it. You know, you want to find people that are going to work with you, and these platforms are easy ways to connect with others. You know, and ultimately, when I work with lawyers, I tell them they should be doing an hour of business development a week. I don't care how they do it, but building into that a 15-minute weekly social media plan. Are you going to update content, find a client alert, post on a blog, do whatever, but track that and see how it works for you, particularly if that's your target audience. And ultimately, through these platforms, you can become a thought leader. You don't want to just be a participant. You want to make yourself known to others. And with the avenues that we have available to us now, it's so much easier than it was even 5 years ago.
Paul, thank you. Ken, how about final thoughts from you?
Final thoughts from me, build out personas. You always want to make sure that you know exactly who you're marketing to. You want to know your target audience, what that customer profile looks like, preferably household income, demographic data, region-specific, persona-specific. You always want to define who your customer is. You don't want to market to the wrong customer with the right amount of marketing efforts, right? That's wasted dollars, lower conversions, and ultimately results in wasted time. Now, with that, you can kind of get a real good feel about that with Facebook, GMB, LinkedIn, and really try to figure out, you know, where are these people hanging out at? What do they like to do? What are their interests? What are their hobbies? Are they social media people? Or are they print people? Do they respond better to radio ads? But with any channel, in any medium, you want to make sure you have a consistent voice, a consistent message that tells who you are, what you do, why you do it, and how it pertains to them. Kind of going back to what Paul said, the days where you can build it and they'll just walk through your door or call you, those days are over with because the competition is too high. So you definitely want to make sure you mirror your market and build your brand. Here locally in Dallas, we have a guy by the name of Jim Adler, who he's everywhere. Like, you'll hardly go one day without hearing some of his radio commercials or one of his TV ads, right? And so the guy has a very great brand. Not a lot of people really know what area of law he practices, but he has that brand recognition because he has a consistent message across various different channels. And so my final thoughts is to build out your persona, keep a consistent voice, and make sure you are keeping a consistent presence.
Great. Thank you, Ken. So we've got some questions for the group, and I encourage you guys, for those of you who are still with us, to type in your questions in the little Q&A box. We have one question. The question is a ruler a measuring device? Adam, you talked about rulers and using Google Analytics. So the answer is yes, right?
The answer is yes. It's not physically a ruler. To be totally honest with you, Google Analytics really is. I mean, that's the measuring device that I meant, the ruler that I meant. Having that on the site and being able to trust the data that goes into it is imperative to your success. If you can't trust the data that you're seeing, you can't make educated decisions on you know, where to go next or what's actually happening on the site.
Great. And data is one of the best ways if you are perhaps a marketing person inside a law firm, and you are a participant today. It's a great way of selling upstream to your lawyers, who can be skeptical and cynical about these things. And data is one way; it's a surefire way of making sure that you've got the best support for your argument. Another question was, what's the current state of newsletters? Have they turned the corner to digital magazines, et cetera? I'm assuming what you mean is print newsletters as opposed to kind of the e-alerts and things like that. I'll go ahead and answer that. I would say that print newsletters have really lost favor for a variety of reasons. They are perceived as unfriendly environmentally. They take too long and cost too much to produce. And by the time they actually sort of get through the U.S. mail service, the information is generally dated. So the most of the firms that we work with, they're really focusing on their e-alerts and electronic updates that they then can syndicate, as if you picture that infographic I showed you, across multiple channels, so that you're getting a much bigger bang for your buck. And, you know, depending on what your design costs are and things like that, it's, you know, a fraction of the cost for the value you're getting. Another question was, what's the difference between desktop and mobile? Don't they work the same? And I think, Adam and Ken, that's for you in terms of your SEO strategy.
Yeah, absolutely. So, there is a difference between desktop and mobile traffic. I'll give you a very good insight. I did some additional research specifically to the legal industry, and you guys have officially gone over 78% of total traffic is mobile. So you would think most of the time people would be using their computer to look up their attorney. Realistically, that tends to not actually be the case. So your mobile traffic, making sure that your site is mobile, making sure that the content is easily read mobile, making sure that you're showing up in the local map section on mobile, are things that are just increasingly imperative that you're doing and being proactive on. That traffic is not the same, and that traffic is actually shows up differently in your Google Analytics as well, so you can track those two things to kind of see where you're getting a good majority of your traffic from.
Great. Just one other thing to add to that is in the analytics that we track also for our website clients, they are viewing mobile pages are typically viewed differently. They are viewing a different number of pages, and the pathway they take in your website is different on a phone, for example, or a tablet than it is on the desktop.
Yeah, that's correct. Again, using the air quotes, the path to purchase via mobile and the path to purchase via desktop are two totally different things. They're just totally different paths that people take, and usually with mobile, they need to be more simplistic, more direct, less content, more easy manual to be able to migrate through.
Great. Thanks, Adam. Another question is, how effective is LinkedIn, Twitter, and Facebook advertising for the legal community? I know from an organic standpoint that LinkedIn, Twitter, and Facebook are very, very effective in terms of delivering content and developing relationships. So you're really attracting your customer or your client on both levels, the short list and the emotional side of hiring. But what I am not an expert in the advertising piece of it. Adam and Ken or Paul, can you comment on that?
I think, you know, from an advertising perspective, the difficulty with lawyers in general, depending on their state bar rules, is how you're going to use social media from an advertising perspective. So the first thing I always say is check the bar rules. The problem with that is a lot of them have not caught up to the social media aspect of things. But in terms of just using LinkedIn to promote what you have from a content standpoint, it's an absolutely incredible way of doing things because you can get it out to people who then push it, will follow it, and as opposed to waiting for people to come in, it's a much more proactive platform to utilize from a marketing standpoint.
Yeah, I would agree with Paul on that as well. I think people are utilizing the social media piece to enhance the SEO, to build up that brand specific, and then the fact that you can turn around and also on the advertising piece be able to specifically go after very specific titles on LinkedIn, and the actual process of targeting people on Facebook, especially in Twitter, has actually become far more robust in the last probably 12 to 15 months. To where you can really dial in on very specific types of people and even figuring out if people are in market, like they're actually in the process of trying to, actually go and find an attorney. And those are certain indicators that Google sets aside to show that people are more likely to purchase than just standard happen to run across your website.
Great. Thanks, Adam and Paul. Mm-hmm. We have one time for one final question. The question is, how do you protect client confidentiality and be discreet and brag about client testimonials? If done anonymously, it seems fabricated. Yes, totally agree about the fabricated piece of that. Paul mentioned state bar rules. We live in Texas, and Texas is very rigid about it, what you can do and what you can't do. My personal view about client testimonials is that the clients should talk about you as a professional and as a person, as opposed to the results of the matter. You cannot talk about results of the matter, even if it's a public, you know, if it's public in the public domain and the information is easily obtained, it is still not recommended to use client testimonials. However, in terms of talking about results, however, you can talk about, the person can talk about, Ellen was so terrific to work with. I knew that she was thinking about my case 24/7, and I, you know, I just had such enormous trust in her and her law firm. So that's a very general but lovely comment, and it's also best if you can have a person's name associated with that. So if, you know, Tom Jones is the one who actually said that, then we would like to use Tom Jones' name with his permission, of course.
Yep, and Deborah, just to add to that, one of the more effective ways to use client testimonials is from verified third parties. If you happen to be ranked in Chambers or Legal 500 or one of those, the rule really, and again, it's specific to jurisdiction, that you can use that if it can be attributed to a verified source. So that's another way to add to your profile.
Great. Great point, Paul. Thank you. That is really all the time we have, I think, for questions. We're at we're at 1 hour, 0.2 minutes and counting. So, Kathleen, I'll turn it back over to you.
Thank you so much, Deborah. And on behalf of LexisNexis, I would like to thank Deborah, Adam, Ken, and Paul for an excellent program today. If you submitted a question and we did not have time to address the question, please feel free to contact our speakers directly using the information provided to you on the final Q&A slide that you're seeing now. Please take a moment and complete the survey that will appear for you at the end of today's webinar. That information allows us to bring you outstanding programs that continue to meet your needs. Thank you all, and have a great day.